Awesome is that. And baptism, awesome, because yesterday was a year memory for me that I had my baptism. And I've been serving the Lord for years. I've been baptized before, but the last year was the time when I said, this is it. I'm not going back. I'm only going forward. So that's awesome about baptism. So look what the Lord has done in this house, in our cities, and in our own lives. So just remember that when you're feeling a little down and out, look what the Lord has done, because there's always a rainbow at the end. So Father God, we just thank you for who you are this morning. We thank you that you are good, God. We just invite you into this place this morning, God. As we go into worship, Lord God, as we go into praise, God, that your glory fall down, Lord God. We just thank you for this time of fellowship, this time that we can come to meet with you. And we just give you all the glory, all the honor, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
If you all want to stand up as we worship, that would be awesome.
Just like you said, there was a verse that I wanted to share this morning. It said home. But it said, and they knew him, and then they sang to him. And they understood who he was. That was kind of the gist of it. But here we are together, and we're getting ready to sing. And why? Because we know him. And because he knows us, and he loves us, and he has pursued us each and every day of our lives. So this morning, as we gather to sing, let's really sing from our hearts, from the bottom of our toes. There was a song I used to sing with my kids that it was from the top of your head to the, from the bottom of your toes to the top of your head, let my song always be a hallelujah. You know, it's something like that. Now I'm forgetting everything because I'm old. And so, it's just from everything that you have in you, let it be given to God this morning in praise, in worship, not just in worship and song, but in worship and prayer, in worship and the word. It's all worship. It's all part of giving back to the Lord, who is the one, the only one, who deserves this, the glory and the honor and the praise to him. Amen. You may be seated. We will greet. Oh, don't sit down. We greet each other first.
Amen.
Okay, hi.
You might not have already got it. I just barely got it.
Hello, Lisa.
Hello, you.
Nice to meet you. Sandy, nice to meet you. I'm so sorry.
Nice job, back in the corner. How you doing? Happy Sunday.
Great, where are you? My kids got to go to Iowa, and we never did.
So,
high school, Ailham. They had a sister city in Ireland, because they were the first John F. Kennedy high school. So they got to play in St. Patty's Day Parade in Dublin.
Oh my gosh.
When they were in high school. Both of my sons, 4 years apart, got to go.
Wow.
How'd you like it? I always wanted to go there.
Never too old. That's what I say.
Yep.
I just learned all kinds of new things about my family.
Can you do that, Cam?
Yes.
Oh, my.
Keep
you
alive. Again.
Yeah, I got a replacement. She just beat up.
She wanted to know if I did it. I said yes. He said good.
Let's get started. I found my scripture. Y'all, you want to hear it? So Psalm 66, 1 through 4 says, shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Make his praises glorious. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that the enemies cringe before you. All the earth bows down to you. They sing praise to you. They sing the praises of your name. Come and see what God has done. His awesome deeds for mankind. Isn't that awesome? God is so good. He's done so many amazing things. In my life, I can only imagine what he's done in your life and what he's going to continue to do in our lives till the day he comes back for us, right?
Yes.
So we've already greeted each other. If you're a new visitor, please, behind the seat in front of you is a visitor's card. If you could fill that out for us, Pastor Juanita would greatly appreciate that. It's just her way of thanking you for coming and reaching out to y'all. We also want to congratulate Elena and Richard for 41 years of marriage. They were telling me they were high school sweethearts, and they've been married for 41 years. They've been together 46, I think he told me. And so that is awesome. You don't see that very often anymore. We want to welcome, of course, Mark back with his full knee replacement. He's going to be running a 5K, 25K marathon in next year. We're doing the mud run together. You're coming with me, and that's all. No questions asked. So Pastor Juanita will be going to Israel, which is awesome. So Pastor Rob will be here on September 4th and September 11th. So that's going to be an awesome time. Pastor Rob is a little firecracker. He's on fire for God. He's there doing such amazing things. Him and his wife, they're beautiful people. They're my leaders for CR, so you might get a little CR while you're here, while they're here. Who knows? Dental, they have some free dental for you available September 30 through October 1st at the State Fair at the Event Center. So if you go on down there, there's some information there. There's flyers and cards in the back for more information. If you need to get some help with your teeth or whatever you need, they will be able to help you out. We're going to be starting a small group September 20th at 9 a.m. here. Elena will be leading. It's called Experiencing God. This is the book. You can order the book online, or if you don't feel comfortable doing that, we can get that ordered for you. I just want to put in a plug on small groups. That's how I started attending Praise Assembly. I emailed about the grief share because I just lost my mom. And Pastor Juanita reached out, and then I came to Grief Share, then I went to Next Steps, and then I went to a couple others, and now I'm leading small groups.
Glory to God.
Amen. A very good part of small groups. That's where you get the community, where you get to know each other, where you get to become a family and to really know each other other than just Sunday morning. So I would encourage you all to be a part of small groups. They're like a lifeline, because you have those connections. And now I'm going to invite Denise up. She's going to talk to us about adopting a classroom.
Okay, if you were here last week, Pastor Juanita and Michelle have gone to speak to the elementary principal, correct? And discussed adopting a classroom, and Pastor Juanita forwarded me, I think, 4 or 5 people that are already interested in doing it. So I went to the district office, and I brought back with me the volunteer application. Now, you can do it online if you want, but you'll have to print it off yourself, right? Print it off, and I already have it printed off. So fill it out, take it in. It has the HR person's card attached to it, and then also behind it, it has how to get online and make your appointment to be fingerprinted, because you're going to have to be fingerprinted, background check. And here in Walsenburg, they only do it on Thursdays. So when you go through this and you get on this site, it'll give you other choices, and I didn't really look very closely. I know you can have it done in Pueblo, and I don't know what day of the week, or if it's every day of the week, so just look through it. I just chose to have it done here this coming Thursday. And then I'm going to try to meet with the principal myself this week, so I'll have more information next Sunday. But if you're interested, pick this up in the back and get online and make an appointment. Because like I said, if you want to do it here in town, it's only Thursdays. So I had to wait a whole week because they didn't have any openings. And if any of you have degrees and you want to teach, there are openings. And I know that Colorado will do alternative certifications, and there's EA positions, paralegals, there's a special education. So that's for Fano County. It's not just here in Los Angeles, but I think in La Vida as well. There's some openings. I just checked this morning, quite a few. So if any of you are interested or know anybody, let them know. Okay? And these will be in the back. Come see me. Thank you.
I think you have my notes. So that's awesome, Adopt a Classroom. I had to, for one of my classes, go and volunteer in the classroom to get credit for it was kind of internship. But it was awesome to go help those kiddos read and just to spend time with them. So if you have that opportunity, I would do it. It's amazing. Little kids are awesome. I work in the school district as well, and they're the best. They just love you. They're not mean like the older kids. And today, of course, we're going to have water baptism. Evelyn is going to get baptized. Yay! God is going to do great things. He's going to do amazing things because you're making that commitment and stepping out in your faith and saying, God, I'm yours. And when we fully surrender our lives to Him, everything is impossible. Nothing is impossible. It's just open road as we walk forward with God. And so we're going to do the offering. Eric and Eric. Eric and Eric, so we're going to go ahead and take that offering. Remember that this is a form of worship as we give to God. We give back to Him what He's given to us, right? He gave us everything. He gave us His Son. He's only requiring 10%. That's all He's requiring. That's all He's asking us. But out of our love and out of our gratitude for Him, we give Him more. Because we could never repay Him for what He's done for us. He gave everything for us. He gave it up because He loves us so much. So we're going to go ahead and pray for the offering. And then we'll start worship, right? Father God, we just thank You for who You are again this morning, God. We ask You to bless this offering, Lord God, that You would bless the finances, God, that it would be flourished, Lord God, that it would prosper, that it would multiply, God, that it would be used for Your kingdom, God, here in Walsenburg. As we reach out, God, You would just return back to us, Lord God, Your glory, Your power, Your strength. In Jesus' name, amen.
I was talking with Richard this morning about our anniversary and the fact that last year in October and November, I wasn't really sure we were going to have a 41st anniversary when he was still sick and in his coma with COVID. I had thought, gosh, that's it. You know, the Lord's going to do what He does. So I was just talking about the fact that each year now is just such a gift. But each day is a gift, isn't it? Each moment is a gift. Yes. And so we can do nothing more but really praise the Holy One. And this is a song that we sang a couple of weeks ago that I introduced. And join in as soon as you catch on because it's not very difficult to sing at all. So come on, stand up and let's give it to God.
Identifying with your Lord and your Savior, and you're go under the water, we identify with his death, and we all our sins there, and we want to confirm that we want to follow Jesus all the days of our life. You want to say anything?
Lord.
Wonder whether it's okay or not, how is this all going to end? I'm going to print up a shirt that says, God wins, the end. Because there's nothing else we have to worry about. So even though it's desperate times right now, let's just know that in this time of desperation, we know who we believe.
Amen.
So today we're going to, I brought some, A Psalm in Your Heart by George O. Wood. I don't know if you know him, but he was our former national superintendent. C.M. Ward in the 1950s, he had a radio called Revival Time. You might be aware of that. And then, if we have time, I will read a sermon from James Stewart from 1937 called The Lord God Omnipotent Reign. So those, and of course we're reading from God's Word, but I brought some of the classics that I'll be referring to as we go today. So in the Psalms, George Wood tells a story of a new Christian, and she was going through a difficult time. She was struggling and in her faith, and she went to a friend who had been a Christ follower for some time, and her friend was trying to encourage her and gave her the promise in 1 Corinthians 10:13. It said, God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. The Lord knows your limits. All of these difficult things would not happen if God thought you couldn't handle them. In fact, it really shows that how much confidence God has in you by letting you go through these difficult times. well, the new believer wasn't so sure about that, and she said, well, I just wish the Lord did not have such a high opinion of me. He figured I could handle all of these things. But as a new Christ follower, you may not know, maybe you have not heard, that this Christian walk is not always easy. Trials do come, fear and doubt can overwhelm us. We can stop and ask, what's going on? Am I blowing it? Is God mad at me? Is he asleep? Maybe he just doesn't care. Maybe he doesn't love me. John 16:33, Jesus was telling his disciples that things were going to happen, that he was going to go away, that they would be scattered, that they would indeed weep and mourn while others, while the world rejoice. It says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take courage. I have overcome the world. Amen. Elena was preaching the word. She was preaching the word. We know the end. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you, God, that you are a good God, that you see us, that you know us, that you love us, that you go before us, Lord. We give you these next few moments. Lord, speak by your Spirit.
Yes.
Speak by your Spirit, God. Open our minds, open our hearts, that we may receive what you have for us today. In your mighty name, amen and amen. Amen. So about 30 years ago, my sister and I were at a time in our lives that every year one of us was having a baby. So if it wasn't me, she was having a baby. So her four kids and my three kids were very close in age, and that makes for really fun cousin time, right? Even if you don't live in the same state. When the boys were finishing middle school, her one and my two, my sister's kid's dad had a terrible, tragic car accident. And my sister needed help in caring for the kids for the summer. And she called and said, could they come and spend the summer with you? And I'm like, of course, you know. But then it's like, how's this gonna happen? How am I gonna, I don't have a car that we can fit all of us in. And we started, that fear and that doubt started to sink in. How are we gonna just survive? How are we gonna feed him? How are we gonna provide for him? And my 16-year-old nephew had just developed diabetes from the trauma of his dad's accident. And I knew nothing about going through diabetes or helping somebody with diabetes, and he barely knew anything. Today, we are going to look at session 3 in Thriving in Babylon. Hope, the title is Hope, Where Courage is Birth. In our culture, when we talk about hope, it's kind of a wishful thinking when we use the term hope. I hope you had a great vacation. I hope your team wins the game. I hope I can lose some weight. It's kind of hopeful thinking. Number one, how does biblical hope differ from the world's idea of hope? A few weeks ago, we heard Daniel was among the best and the brightest in the Israelites. He had taken captive to exile in Babylon. Daniel had three powerful traits: hope, humanity, and wisdom. But you take those traits away, and Daniel would have become just another victim. Do you see yourself as a victim today? Hope was Daniel's unmistakable source of incredible courage and confidence. Hope is where courage is birthed. Daniel didn't just wish that everything would be okay. He just didn't dream or visualize that everything would be okay. He knew that, a matter of fact, that everything would be okay. That there was no need to panic in a situation. God was in control of who was in control. Daniel had a biblical sense of the word hope. He had a deep-seated confidence in God's character and his sovereignty. Daniel had peace, even in the midst of the great tribulation he was living in. Can you say that of your life today? Daniel didn't just survive, he thrived. It's our human nature to make our own plans and then ask God to bless them. Instead, Let's seek God first. Communicating with God allows us Him to give us counsel and to give His wisdom to us. When our pieces of the life, we don't know how they're going to fit together, but God knows how they're going to fit together. So we shouldn't try to have to figure it out. We should trust Him. Listen to His voice of discernment and follow His leading. Number two, the daily offering of incense. Jehovah Shammah means the Lord is there. The Lord my command. God's presence is not limited or contained just in the tabernacle or the temple, but is accessible to all of us who obey and love Him. I hope you can feel His presence here today. We can fill each day to the brim with Christian activity until there's less and less room for anything else. We can get so busy working for God that we forget God. We can lose out by neglecting the altar just inside the prayer curtain, the altar of personal communion with God. I can become too busy. Daniel chose the altar of prayer and praise. In Daniel 6:10, now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows were open toward Jerusalem. Three times a day he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. Daniel was a savvy political consultant. He knew that his enemies were lying in wait for him, and he knew the penalty for continuing to pray to God. Yet, Daniel was unwilling to change his prayer habits, even at the risk of his own safety. And we just read, so with the windows open, he knelt down on his knees three times a day and prayed. He knew that when spiritual and earthly realms clash, the spiritual calling always takes precedence, no matter what. You'll need more of your own good works to see you through. You'll need more than your own good works to see you through. You will need God's presence. Watch out for the enemy of your soul. He will allow you to fill your day so full that you will lose out on your quiet time. Is there anything lacking in your life today? Do you feel empty and alone today? Have you been neglecting your prayer time, your private devotions? Any service we perform for God cannot take the place of waiting upon God. The fire on the altar must never go out. Jesus could meet the needs of the multitude by day only because he communed with his Father when the day was spent and the shadows had lengthened. When you are struggling, don't ask, why, Lord, why me? Why is this happening to me? Kneel before him and ask and say, what do you want me to learn from this, Lord? Help me see it. Help me hear it. Help me learn it. Don't let the fire go out at the altar. We must offer our sweet prayers, our prayers of sweet incense to our Lord and Savior. Number three, a glimpse of the miraculous. Read with me from Daniel 6, 16 through 26. So the king gave the order that they brought Daniel and threw him in the lion's den. The king said to Daniel, may your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you. A stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den. The king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the rings of his nobles so that Daniel's situation might not be changed. Then the king returned to his palace and spent the night without eating and without any entertainment being brought to him. And he could not sleep. At the first light of dawn, the king got up and hurried to the lion's den. When he came near the den, he called out to Daniel in an anguished voice, Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continuously, been able to rescue you from the lions? Daniel answered,
May the king live forever. My God sent his angels, and he has shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me, because I was found innocent in his sight. Nor have I ever done any wrong before you, your majesty. The king was overjoyed and gave orders to lift Daniel out of the den. And when Daniel was lifted from the den, there was no wound found on him, because he had trusted in his God. Verse 24, at the king's command, the men who had falsely accused Daniel were brought in and thrown into the lion's den, along with their wives and children. And before they reached, I just want to say sin spreads right there, sin spreads. And when, before they reached the floor of the den, the lions overpowered all the earth. And they, I got overwhelmed there. We brought them in, thrown in the lion's den, along with their wives and children. And before they reached the floor of the den, the lions overpowered them and crushed all their bones. Then King Darius wrote to all the nations and the peoples and to every language and all the earth, may you prosper greatly. I issue a decree that in every part of my kingdom, people must fear and reverence the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, and he endures forever. His kingdom will not be destroyed. His dominion will never end. He rescues and he saves. He performs signs and wonders in the heavens and on the earth. He has rescued Daniel from the power of the lions. So Daniel prospered during the reign of King Darius and the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Wow. Wow. King Darius and Daniel both experienced the miracle of the lion's den, but from very different perspectives. King Darius sounded like he believed God, right?
Yep.
I hope your God will keep you. I hope your God will keep you safe. But then he went and spent a sleepless night worrying and anxious. Daniel, on the other hand, was at peace and in God's will, even among the lions. Even though he was still in the pit, he was not filled with despair. Darius spent a vantage point in witnessing the miracle was a spectator from afar. But in contrast, Daniel experienced the miracle firsthand. He could feel the protection of God's hand because he believed. When we trust in God, we will recognize his touch,
yes,
in our lives. We will feel his breath on the side of our face. We will hear his voice in our ears. We will hear his spirit speaking in our heart. Hope is where courage is birthed. What kind of person have you become? What is your vantage point? You can be honest, but hard. You can be clean, but calloused. You can be successful, but selfish. You can be moral, but miserable. And you can't live on someone else's experience of God. Beth Grant, who is a missionary in India to self-trafficked victims, says it like this. Authentic Pentecostal leaders are spirit-filled and anointed for ministry by the Spirit day by day. They must seek God passionately and welcome his unmistakable presence with them, approaching each day with readiness to hear God's voice, sense his guidance, and obey him in faith. Others will know you as a people who walk in God's presence. Listen for his voice. Sense and discern and respond to his spirit. Amen. For Jesus is our higher power. He is the one and our only true higher power. Many people today believe their doubts and doubt their beliefs, saying that we have come to believe in Jesus as our higher power describes a process. Belief is a result of consideration, doubt, reasoning, and concluding. For he can do for us what we have never been able to do for ourselves. 2 Corinthians 12:9 says, Jesus tells us, my grace is enough for you. For where there is weakness, my power is shown the more completely. What is the process that leads to that solid belief, which leads to a changed life? Sometimes we're afraid to change. Even if our past was painful, we resist change because of our fear of the unknown, or in our despair, we think we don't deserve anything better. Here's the good news. Hope opens doors where despair has closed them. Hope discovers what can be done instead of grumbling about what can't be done. Throughout your life, you will continue to encounter hurts and trials that you are powerless to change. You will continue to encounter hurts and trials that you are powerless to change. But with God's help, you can be open to allow the circumstances and situations to change you, to make you better, not bitter.
Amen.
Power to change comes from God's grace. You see, hope draws its power from a deep trust in God. Like that of the psalmist who wrote in Psalms 25:5, lead me, teach me, for you are the God who gives me salvation. I have no hope except in you. The Bible tells us again and again that the coming of the Lord will be sudden, not gradual. Matthew 25:13 says, therefore keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour. My Bible says it will happen in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, in 1 Corinthians 15. Christ's coming will not be progressive. On the other hand, the signs of his return are progressive. And the signs of the midnight are about us. These are on the outward signs that he will soon be coming. We don't know the year, we don't know the hour, we don't know the day. But God tells us in his holy word that we do not have to be ignorant, that we may read the signs of his coming. You are in no condition to meet Jesus today if you have allowed yourself to run dry. If your testimony before the world is in danger of fading out, I encourage you to get down on your knees. Do something about it. Don't wait another day, because the bridegroom cometh. Get ready to meet Jesus. You'll never be sorry. Step out and say, I will move my feet once more towards God. I will open my heart once more towards heaven. I will open my mind and spirit once more towards this man of Galilee. I will see for myself what he can do in the heart of a man and a woman who will yield himself completely to him. It's the midnight hour in man's history. Murder, violence, insanity, suicide are very commonplace. Don't let this darkness swallow you up. In the midst of your misery, reach out to God. Wake up now. Wake up before it's too late. Take that all-important step towards God. Ask God to forgive your sins. Don't pass up the greatest opportunity of an invitation that heaven has ever extended. An invitation to attend the wedding of the ages. Behold, the bridegroom comes. Go out to meet him. God has come as far as he can towards you. He stands at the door of your private life and knocks. He's waiting for your invitation to come in. That's as far as God can come towards you. The next move is up to you. Today, face the issues as though you were on your deathbed. You are not promised tomorrow. What will you do with Jesus? Neutral, you cannot be. Someday your heart will be asking, what will he do with me? 5, open up ancient gates. Psalms 24:7-10 says, open up ancient gates, open up ancient doors, and let the King of glory enter in. Who is this King of glory? the Lord strong and mighty, the Lord invincible in battle. Open up, ancient gates, open up, ancient doors, and let the King of glory enter. Who is this King of glory? Oh, the Lord of heaven's armies, he is the King of glory. This psalm was often set to music and used in corporate worship. It may have been reacted many times in the temple. It went like this. The people outside would call for the temple gates to open and let the King of glory in. From inside, the priest or another group would say, "Who is this King of glory?" Outside, the people would respond in unison, "The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord invincible in battle," proclaiming God's strength and his power. This exchange would be repeated, and the temple gates would swing open, symbolizing the people's desire to have God's presence among them. Psalms 24 in the Complete Jewish Christian Bible reads like this. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, everlasting doors, so that the glorious King can enter. Who is this glorious King? Adonai, strong and mighty. Adonai, battle, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, everlasting door, so that the glorious King can enter. Who is he, this glorious King? Adonai, Shavat. He is the glorious King. Adonai Shavat is the Lord of hosts who comes in victory. Praise God.
Amen.
Praise God. Number 7, David like courage and Paul like peace. Paul says in Philippians 4, 8 and 9, "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you." If we want to experience Daniel-like courage and Paul-like peace, we need to follow their examples. Instead of letting our friends or the media latest crisis determine our outlook, let's look to Scripture and our personal experience of God's power and his promises to determine our outlook. Do you need God to help you with your outlook? Think more on whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable. For some of us that might be hitting that mute button on your device, right?
Amen.
Silencing the panic voices that's feeding the fear and drowning our hope. Because ultimately, it's not our circumstances that determine our outlook. It is the way we interpret our circumstances that determine our outlook. Spiritual myopia is when I am so focused on the evil in front of me that I can't see anything else. There's an old computer term, garbage in, garbage out. If you feed a computer false data, it will give you false results. And that's how our faith is. How does your daily media intake influence your hope level? If we claim to be followers of Jesus, there's never a good reason to panic. A mess does not intimidate God. It takes a mess to have a miracle. Amen. Psalm 16, 7 and 8. "I will bless the Lord who guides me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I know the Lord is always with me. I will not be shaken, for he is right beside me." David says he will not be shaken. That's the unique sense of security felt by believers. No matter what comes our way, we will not be overcome. We will not be shaken. Instead of sinking into despair, we hit our knees, we raise our hands, and we say, "Lord God, help me, mighty and good and strong. You are glorious. You are glorious. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Titus 2:11 says, "For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions
and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. What does Paul say is our instructor, our teacher, to turn us from the godless living and sinful pleasures? Was the grace of God that brings salvation and acts as our teacher. What are we instructed to do instead? Live in this evil world with wisdom, righteousness, and devotion to God. And what, according to this passage, should we hope for? The wonderful day of God's Jesus' return, the blessed hope. When the Bible says Jesus returns is our blessed hope, that doesn't mean we hope he will come. Oh, I just wish he would come. No, we are certain and confident Christ will return. The biblical concept of hope goes far beyond wishful thinking to absolute confidence. Biblical hope involves the rock-solid truth that God is in control of our universe. Every wrong will be righted. Every tear will be wiped away. Justice and the coming kingdom will prevail. All of this comes because of Jesus, his death on the cross, and his amazing resurrection.
Amen.
Symbolized here today. He will come again, and he will make all things right and good. This is the basis of our true biblical hope. Romans 8:28 says, "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, for who has been called according to his purpose." That's not happy talk. That's not just a Christian cliche or a phrase on a coffee mug. That is a deep spiritual truth. It is a spiritual truth that hope, what hope is built on. It's not to say that everything happens is good. It's to say that nothing beyond his ability to redeem or overcome for his good purposes. He took the damnable Friday and turned it into Good Friday.
Amen.
The crucifixion of Jesus was the greatest act of injustice and triumph of evil that will ever take place. Yet today, we celebrate it. When Sunday came, everything changed.
Amen.
We have a God who allowed all but one of the apostles to be martyred. What a devastating time that must have looked like in the early church. But the blood of the martyrs turned into seed of the church. What looks like victory for Satan is really just another step towards his ultimate defeat.
Amen.
Nothing has changed. Our God is still at work, even when it looks as if all is about to be lost. God is never surprised. He is never overmatched. I may not understand his plan or agree with his timing, but he is God. I am not. We know the end of the story. Elena was preaching. God wants to fill our life with his love, his joy, his presence. God is looking for you, no matter how lost you feel today. God's searching love can find you, no matter how many times you've fallen into sin. God's hands of mercy are reaching out to pick you up, to love you, and forgive you. John 16:33, once again, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take courage. I have overcome the world." Praise God. Praise God. You know, there were challenges that summer when the kids came, but even through the times that started out as a tragedy, and the challenge were great, God made a way. And to this very day, the kids say that was the best summer ever. God can take a tragedy and make it the best day ever. Praise God. Amen. I wanted to read from the 1937 James Stewart. I don't know, do you have 6 more minutes in you?
Yes.
6 more minutes. I'm not going to read it all. But from 1937, the Lord God, omnipotent, reigned. He quotes Revelation 19:6. "Hallelujah, the Lord God, omnipotent, reigneth. The release from petty worries when our mind obsesses and we see and hear only darkness. We need to run and bring our worries to the great light of truth. Release from worry, release from fear, release from self-contempt, the liberation of life. We sometimes talk pessimistically about the future of Christianity. We find ourselves wondering, what will the ultimate issue in the warfare between good and evil? But the writer of Revelation tells us what the outcome will be. One look at society today will surely not think so. When we look at the chaos in today's morals, we will see how evil flaunts itself in the open and how it strikes its roots deeper and deeper. But I know that if God is on the throne of the universe, then evil is doomed, the battle is lost. Know all the saints sing, hallelujah! Babylon is fallen, is fallen. What makes John write such things? He sees a throne upraised above the earth, and on the throne the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. God is on the throne, therefore evil is doomed. Here on the rock, Jesus said once, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Do you ask, what is the mainspring of Christianity? Hope and courage. It is the certainty that we are not fighting a losing battle, that evil flaunt itself as it may carry the seal of its own doom upon it, and that the real pull of the universe is on the side of the man who goes out for righteousness. Fight on then, you have lost heart, because your own conflict is so difficult. Your tempter so strong and dogged and selfish. Fight on is your battle, not his, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. We know two things for sure and certain. We have the liberation of life and the doom of sin. What shall we say on the days which every soul must now win? As Jesus put it, the rain descends and the floods come and the winds blow and beat us upon the course. Until your whole structure of things, all of your philosophy of life is threatened to come toppling down. What about the happiness you build for your life? The plans you lay, the dreams you dream, the hopes you cherish, and the heart's desire you yearn for. And then thinking and the rolling mountains high come and the waves and the breakers crashing down on the shore of your dreams, leaving only some sore bits of wreckage behind. What then? Why then, blessed be God, the Lord sits at the King of the flood. The Lord sits King forever, which simply means that the heartbreaking things of life have meaning and purpose and grace in them, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. There was a terrible night on the Galilean lake when the sudden whirlwind blew and the sea was lashed to flirt and the boat struggled in the troughs of the wave. And the disciples were telling themselves, our last hour has come, this is the end. And there was Jesus sleeping through it all. Master, Master, careth thou not that we perish? But that night they learned by the grace of God this lesson, that there is something higher in human experience than life's waves and storm. There is a Christ who rules the waves. Have you discovered that? This great thing? When the floods begin, the desolations of sorrow comes beating down, to hear the divine supreme chord, lift up your hearts. For the Lord sits at the flood, your flood, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. There was once a flood called Calvary, and all the bitterness and ugliness, all the shame and sorrow of life entered into that flood and came beating around the brave soul of Jesus, sweeping him down at last to the barbarity and the infamy of death on the cross. What can God have been doing, we want to ask? Was he asleep? Or was he on a journey? Was he dead? The Lord was sitting as king at the flood, that surging flood of Calvary, and at the grim cross, he has brought the salvation of the world. Tell me, if God did that with the cross of Jesus, do you think your cross can be too difficult for him to deal with and transfigure? Can he make it shine with glory? Do you believe it? My friend, here is surely the final victory of faith, to be able to say, the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. to cry it out loud, not only when life is kind and tender and smiling, but even more when the night is dark and you are far away from home and the proud waters are going over your soul. To cry it then, not weakly or uncertainly, but passionately, with a ring of faith in every syllable. The Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Hallelujah. This is the Lord God who has come again to the gate of your life and mine today. This is the Lord God who claims the right to reign and from whose patient, haunting pursuit we can never in this world get free. Behold, he stands at the door and knocks. While the sands of time are running out and the hurrying days form our destiny, he stands at the door and knocks. More tender than the kiss of a little child, mightier than the flashing lightnings of heaven, he stands at the door and knocks. What will your answer be? You out there at the door, you who have been haunting and troubling me all of these years, be gone and leave me in peace. Is that what you'll say? Or is it rather this blessed and glorious Lord Almighty, dear loving Christ of God, come. Come now. My life is yours. See, here is the throne. O Christ, take your power and reign. The Lord God omnipotent reign. Amen. Let's pray. Elena, if you want to come. Praise you, Jesus. We thank you, God. We thank you, Lord God, that you are mighty, that you are strong, that you are great, that you see us, that you hear us, Lord. In our desperate times, when things sweep over our souls in the darkness, when our bodies forsake us, when our minds leave us, when our hearts grow faint, God, you are our God. We cry out to you today. We cry out, Lord, we love you. We exalt you, God. Have your kingdom reign here on earth as it is in heaven. Let us not forget your sacrifice on the cross. Let us not forget. Let's not get too busy. Let's not get too doing good things that we forget to silence our heart before you, to come before you, to fall on our face, to fall on our knees and cry out, Lord God Almighty, you reign. You reign forever. We praise you. We praise you. We praise you in your mighty name. Amen and amen.